Subject for this evening in this continuing series is an investigation of New York Modern. The subject of this exhibition, as a title and as a kind of investigation of the decade, especially the decade of the 1920s, and an argument that American modernism was in some ways born of the condition of the modern American city, and that is especially New York. Ferriss was an adopted New Yorker. Can I have the next, please? And he made his fortune to some extent here. He certainly made his life in New York and was really a complete through and through New Yorker. You see him there at his drafting board in his studio. The next, please. Let's go one forward and then we'll come back. Which was on the top floor, a walk-up beyond the elevator, the top floor of the elevators on the 16th floor of the Architects Building at 101 Park Avenue, since replaced by a modern building, where he had an atelier, a studio with a glass wall that looked south on the city. So over Park Avenue, towards the south, the next please, towards Madison Square Park and the towers of the city, like the Metropolitan Life Tower that you see there, and by the late 20s, the New York Life Insurance Building. It was a place where he observed the city, he soaked it in, he worked day and night, and he always worked alone. So the inquiry that we'll make tonight is partly about Ferriss as an artist and a poet, a writer about the city, and partly as an influence over other artists, but especially architects, and how his drawings operated within the culture of architecture in order to really change the thinking, the mindset about what it meant to be modern architecture in the 1920s. And let's go back to the cover of Metropolis. Thanks. I was asked by an Italian encyclopedia recently to write an essay on the Metropolis of Tomorrow, not on Ferriss, but on the book and on the book's influence. And it's something that, in thinking about for tonight's lecture as well, I reflected on and I suppose dredged up some of the same thoughts that I had 20 years ago about really what can we say of import about the influence of this book separate than the influence of the man, or vice versa, because it really is this book that makes Ferriss's reputation for history, just as the book was extremely popular in the 1920s, and I'll read you some of the reviews by critics, both laudatory and scathing by Lewis Mumford, for example. So he was a figure that was much discussed within architectural circles. He was an influence within the architecture community. He was the president of the Architectural League of New York. He was extremely active, as were his colleagues at the time and in this exhibition in thinking about the future city, Harvey Wiley Corbett and Raymond Hood. But this book seemed to be really a summary of the ideas about the city of the future, and in thinking about the future, about the direction that modern architecture would take in America in the 1920s. And what we'll look at over the lecture and the series of slides that we'll explore through his drawings, his career, we'll look minutely at the evolution of his architectural draftsmanship and his thinking about architectural representation in the 1920s, his early ideas about what modernism is, and then his projections about the ambitions for urban planning that he clearly articulated in his drawings and equally in his writings. So what was the influence of The Metropolis of Tomorrow as a book? It had, I think, no lasting influence beyond 1929 and 1930, when it was when it was embraced by so many and so lauded in the press and also so criticized. So it was controversial at the time, but it was most definitely eclipsed by two things. The first one, of course, is the stock market crash and the depression that followed, and the decline in building activity and construction in New York, and then the long slide of inactivity, the hiatus before a revival after World War I, when the other thing that affected the lack of influence of Ferriss was international style modernism, a European imported style that was exactly contrary to the aesthetic that Ferriss was propounding in his work, and which architects in New York and across America were embracing through the early 1920s and defining in this American modernism, or even New York modernism, by the late 1920s. So that's the territory that we're going to explore tonight. The next new one, thanks. So Ferriss overlooked the city, and he clearly is the projection of the figure, the solitary figure in all of these drawings. And there are many like this. This is clearly the view from his studio parapet. And I'd like to sort of sprinkle the slides with some of the writings of Ferriss through quotes from a variety of sources, including the Metropolis of Tomorrow. He talks about the experience of the city, and he talks about rendering in exactly the same terms. The fog and the haze. He writes, and I must go back one for a second for that. This is his parapet and his easel, as you can see. He writes of often working through the night and then seeing the city emerge through through the fog as dawn hits the building masses. And he says, a subtle differentiation is perceived in the monotone of gray. Vertical lines of a tone, but a degree more luminous, have magically appeared beneath him. Every eastern facade in the city is pale with light. Contrast increases. As mysteriously as though being created, a city becomes distinguishable, pristine, and still. And let me have the next one, too. Leaning at dusk, and he often also reverses nature by showing the city at night in his drawings, then illuminated by electric light, so the light is artificial, but the forms are still thrown in dramatic contrast. Leaning at dusk against the dark rail, one will regard roofs spread out before and spread out below for miles and miles, blue and silent. Distant office buildings, their contours lost on the dusk, will reveal brilliantly lit interiors. Later they will darken window by window. At midnight, no longer disturbed by little people, they will resume. So it will seem to the watcher on the roof, their night-long communion, how calm and sculptural. Sculpture, mass, light, architecture is sculpture, becomes the mode of expression in Ferriss's architectural drawings. And indeed, expression and emotion are the words that best describe his architectural style. I guess I could probably invoke Stephen Colbert in this particular format, because Stephen Colbert has this brilliant way of saying he feels the news for you. He doesn't critique the news. He doesn't analyze the news like Jon Stewart. He feels the news for you. Ferriss feels the buildings for you. And this is his means of expression. The next, please. And he is always a romantic. He's called a rationalist by his colleagues and contemporaries, which is a bit confounding in these days, because one always in his drawings sees the city as a kind of distant fantasy, phantasmagoria. The next, please. And his view of the city has a kind of theatrical and operatic quality as well. This is an image that we'll see often. It could well be a set from Aida, given the terraces going down, but this is a 1922 drawing that he did for the new architecture. It's back in the gallery, in which he also, on the companion page, rendered or illustrated the four stages of the zoning envelope. And in this article that he wrote himself for the New York Times magazine, March 19, 1922, he talks about how a new architecture will be born in the zoning law, that not just that buildings will take on a new form, but the city itself. He says, the law, the zoning law, regards the building operations not from the point of view of the individual, plotter, the owner, or the designer, but the argus-eyed viewpoint of the city itself. So it's that concern for the civic realm, for architecture, not really as so much as city planning in a technocratic sort of way, but in a sort of utopian romance with creating a new city, a city that can be controlled, not in contrast to the laissez-faire version of the metropolis of the turn of the century that we looked at last week, the last time. Next, please. And it's in The Metropolis of Tomorrow and in a series of events, which are commissions for either advertisements or magazine illustrations, exhibitions at a department store, an exhibition that he mounts himself, his own ambition to show his work as an artist, as an architectural artist, in 1925. And we'll look at this evolution from 1922 on of a change in his architectural rendering style and in his idea of what architecture is, moving towards the idea of architecture as mass and an emotional truth in building as a sculptural form. And you can see that clearly in the works of the later 1920s and the next. 1920s, period. In contrast to men with whom he collaborated on very important commissions and who inspired and sort of what propelled some of his thoughts about civic architecture. Harvey Wally Corbett, we'll look at next time, Raymond Hood there, and the other associated architects of Rockefeller Center and the project team managing this large project that you can see importantly in these little models of plasticine clay models, and we'll be looking at other of these, because this idea of architecture in mass really characterizes the approach to architecture that American architects who consider themselves searching for a modern style embrace in the 1920s. And it's in sharp contrast, as we discussed the last time, with the idea of architecture as space or volumes of contained by screens. That's characteristic of the avant-garde approach among European architects like Le Corbusier or the Bauhaus. The next, please. So the collaborations with these important businessmen move Ferriss's ideas along, but they're in stark contrast, as we'll see next week, with Corbett, who heads a rather large office and has big commercial commercial real estate commissions, and likewise Raymond Hood, who's a little bit more of an artiste, but equally a businessman in securing commissions, who designs some of the most interesting of American skyscrapers in New York, and of course the Chicago Tribune, which launches his career. But Ferriss remains a single solitary figure. He's an artist who always works alone. He doesn't have a big office. He has a job book in which he writes by hand. It's in Avery Library. Every single one of the commissions that he gets and how much he charges for them. And in this one book, it comprises the whole decade of the 1920s, when his career really ascended from around 1921, when I think he made something like $1,400 a year, to about $20,000 a year by 1929, which is more than certainly a lot more than the $5 a day that Henry Ford paid for offered for working in his Ford automobile factory, but was considered a very good living wage, and a lot more than, if you compare to a rather successful lawyer in the same time, would have made about $15,000 a year. So Ferriss did become extremely successful over the span of the decade of the 1920s, which of course was the great building boom period of American architecture as well. But he wasn't a businessman. He was an artist. But he worked with businessmen like Corbett, who commissioned Ferriss to render that drawing for an article that he wrote for the New York Times Magazine. The next, please. To render a series of images that were commissioned by the Regional Plan of New York and its environs, this in 1923-24. Planners who were engaged in a serious and really pioneering effort to statistically record the modern city, to endorse and try to direct its growth towards decentralization at the same time that it recognized centralization as important. So the Regional Plan of New York and its environs, which is still survives today as the Regional Plan Association, was the sort of technocratic end of the spectrum of city planning, where Ferriss was much more at the romantic and the utopian end. But nevertheless, he worked across that span. The next, please. And early on, in 1923-24, or a collaboration with Raymond Hood in an article where Hood was promoting some of his ideas for point towers, widely separated in a future city, which he called Pinnacle Towers, and he promoted in 1924 in the New York Times Magazine. So these were ideas that were very much a part of the popular culture at the moment. If you opened your New York Times in 1924, you'd be seeing the ideas played out of a visionary city by leading architects of the day. Although by 1924, not quite so leading as they would be in the following years. The next, please. So they were making a bid for their own reputations as well. And collaborating with Hood on the idea of bridge homes that we saw, we can see around the corner in the exhibition, and we saw last week. The next, please. So when Ferriss came to New York, he was born and raised in the Midwest. He was the son of a judge, so a fairly affluent family in St. Louis. He went to school there at Washington University. He trained in architecture. He came to New York in 1912 with a letter of introduction to take around to architectural offices. The first place he went was to Cass Gilbert's office, and of course Cass Gilbert is the architect of many important buildings, but in terms of skyscrapers, his masterpiece is the Woolworth Building, and it was under construction when Ferriss arrived at the Gilbert office. He was offered a job as an intern. The first 3 months he wasn't paid at all, and then he stayed there for about a year and a half, and he was paid $85 a week, a month, I think. So not very much, but he got important experience there. One learned the practice of architecture in an office, in a kind of internship or journeyman kind of relationship. He did a lot of rendering in the Gilbert office, and he decided during the time that he was there that he didn't want to be a practicing architect, but rather that he wanted to express his love of architecture through drawing, and he wanted to try to make a living by being an architectural renderer, an artist of architecture. The next, next please. And an early rendering of the Woolworth Building that he did, you can see here. And you can see that his style tends towards realism in the early style. It has the kind of soft focus that's an inclination that we'll see in his more characteristic style of the 1920s. But nevertheless, there is a great deal of detail as an articulation of the surface and of ornament. And there's certainly a lot of surrounding urban context. So in the teens, this is the direction of his architectural expression. I think next, please, we'll see by contrast some of the things that are going on in the same in the milieu of New York that he occupies as this young man in his early 20s. The same year, 1913, John Maron, we looked at last time, sees the Woolworth Building in this, one could call it kind of expressionistic style. And he writes about it with about the sound and the tumult of the city. Maron is a part of the Stieglitz Circle, the artists who are exploring the ideas of modernism by looking especially to European avant-garde theorists and artists like Picasso and Braque, and they're aware of Cubism and the other movements of expressionism. The next, please. And around New York, there are lovers of modern art who are trying to advance its cause. And in the 1913 Armory Show that we looked at last time, too, you can see Brancusi's work of Mademoiselle Pagani. You can see German Expressionist sculpture and a whole range of paintings. So imported European modernism and Americans who are in many ways imitating the trends and the isms that one finds in contemporary European art. Next, please. At the 1913 Armory Show, Marcel Duchamp showed his new Descending a Staircase, and the typical split that one finds between the European avant-garde and those, especially the sort of Greenwich Village bohemians who were embracing both the lifestyle and the modern artist aesthetic, and the reactions of the more general populace, including the cartoonist from the Evening Sun, who sees the Rube descending a staircase being the kind of cubism of a chaotic city. The next, please. So there was definitely, you can't even say a dialogue about modern art and modern architecture in the teens in the U.S. There really wasn't any, except in these small circles, a small coterie like the Stieglitz Circle of artists and his stable from his gallery, and there was a modern movement in photography, but there wasn't much within architecture. There was very little self-conscious modernism, although there was certainly a lot of discussion about style and what style was appropriate. So in this context, Ferriss tried to eke out a living as an architectural artist, and he received commissions from Sunday supplements. This is for the New York Public Library, for I think it's the Herald Tribune. The next, please. In a charcoal rendering. And somewhat dramatic, it's from the Avery collection. A night view, again, which is one of his favorite ways to see the city. But here you see the human figure articulated in a way where he usually pulls back by the later 20s and just sees the sort of massive and monumental forms of the skyscrapers and the large forms of the city. But these early, much more sort of narrative and theatrical images are what was very saleable as he tried to make his living. The next, please. There's a whole range of them, and what you can see in the drawing style is a typical approach of the 19-teens, like Joseph Pennell or other architectural renderers and other artists who used the pen and ink style. Ferriss had explored many media. The Paulist Church here shows you what he achieved in pen stroke instead of in charcoal, which becomes his favorite medium. So that the sensibility there of the dark forms set off by the artificial light and the highlights are part of the sensibility that he eventually is going to resolve in his own approach through his own distinctive characteristic media, and you can see the individual lines in the sky. So this is, he's still working with a technique that doesn't really suit his purposes yet. Next, please. Other of the commercial drawings, this is a warship, so it reminds us that in 19 18, the U.S. and New York is very much a part of the war effort of World War I. The next, please. And then a few images sort of invade what sort of project an idea and a direction in his work. When he takes up the charcoal chalk or charcoal pencil, and instead of pen and ink, when he works as in sort of planes of gray, establishing the darks, he's still defining certain forms, but the rest of the building seemed to sort of fall back into the fog. That description of the experience of the city from his rooftop begins to be imitated in his drawing style in the late 19-teens, and you can begin to see it in drawings like this. The next, please. We'll interrupt that thought in order to look at a series of drawings that were created of the Bush House in London, designed by Harvey Wiley Corbett, which is the centerpiece building there, and is a commission drawing that's meant to, of course, highlight the architecture by his client. So this is a commercial drawing commissioned by Corbett in order to feature his building for architectural representation in a magazine. The next, please. You can see how Ferriss defines through lines in these early drawings and these rather more highly articulated drawings. The architectural form still keeps the dramatic focus on the building that's being featured, but develops a great deal of detail in the context of the existing city streets. And then the last one, where the streets become populated with carriages and people, and so there becomes a much more sort of naturalistic urban scenography, or even go so far as to say realism to the representation of the building. So this is a drawing of about 1922, and it was meant to show the stages of development and the technique by which he constructed drawings. The next, please. This will begin to change after 1922 in the zoning envelope drawings, which we'll look at in a minute. But the commercial renderings that by the early 1920s started to form a basis for his career as an architectural delineator or renderer. He actually sort of invented the term delineator. He used it to describe what he did and he wrote an essay for the Encyclopedia Britannica on architectural rendering, where he explains this profession, which was not all that well defined when he started to establish a career. But he begins to work for architects to make presentation drawings in this dramatic style. This is for Bertram Goodhue. It's a building that was never constructed, but was to have been on the Madison Square Garden site at the corner of Madison Square and 27th Street. So the old Madison Square Garden would have been torn down. It's now occupied by the skyscraper that was built in 1928, the New York Life Insurance Building. But this would have been a 70-story tower that was called the Convocation Tower. It was the client was to have been a group of church organizations, so that at the base would have been a chapel, and the tower would have been the combined offices of all of these associated charities and religious groups. The next, please. You can see that romance of a night representation is something that Ferriss is continuing to explore, even in this more traditional type of architectural commission, the presentation drawing. And you can see in how it stands in dramatic contrast to the kind of representation that was common in these years. This is Goodhue's design for the Nebraska State Capitol. It won the competition, widespread competition for the Capitol building, with a rendering here that sort of takes the conventions of Beaux-Arts drafting and brings them into the 20th century with a modernist inclination in terms of the design. You can see the same sort of conventions that were being explored in the Congregation Tower in these heavy buttresses that are on the that. Hold tight the sort of upright stability of this tower, which is, of course, an iconic tower that says Capitol, but it also has office space within the tower. So it's a program, this is, I think I said 1917, that combines the 20th century functions of an office building with the sort of heraldic and civic functions or governmental functions of a state capital. And this building was perceived to be, in the late 19-teens, an extreme example of modernist progressive design. The next, please. We looked last time, too, at the Chicago Tribune competition of 1922, and we saw this drawing, which is Goodhue's drawing, and was awarded an honorable mention for his entry for the Chicago Tribune competition. And Goodhue died in 1924, so he was his influence was cut short in what would have, I'm sure, been an even more promising career than the important buildings that that he did design, including St. Bart's, for example, in New York. He began early on, and you can see this in the previous two drawings, to explore the idea of a simplified sculptural form. So these heavy buttress corners give the building great weight and strength. They have this lithic quality, a kind of pyramid mass. And the building, as you can see, has sheer walls and planes that catch the light so that the thing seems incredibly solid and monolithic. And that sensibility is something that, in which Ferriss, I'm sure, found great sympathy with his own tendencies to emotionalize his architecture. What he called truth in architecture was the emotion that it projected. So there's little doubt in my mind that Ferriss would have found a kind of fellowship in Goodhue's designs. The next, please. And so as we explore 1922 in American architecture, we're looking at a series of designs that are sort of harbingers of a direction that the rest of the decade will play out in defining a modernist aesthetic. And we'll look at, by contrast, some others. Now, this is Holabird and Roche's entry, a Chicago firm, but it was rendered by Hugh Ferriss, which only knew by his job book, it's because it's not signed in any way. And you can see that there is a kind of soft focus, but yet a really solid monumentality to the building. And whether that representation is Ferriss's inclination or Holabird and Roche's is hard to know, because nothing much was written about this entry. The next, please. But a lot was written about all the other entries, of which there were well over 200. This was Harvey Wally Corbett's, and as you can see, the kind of filigree Gothic ornamentation that you see at the on the spire is something that is certainly doesn't have the dignity and stability and solidity that that is the Goodhue sensibility. The next, please. And there were, as we saw last time, a whole range of somewhat hilarious entries, like Frank Fort, a New York architect who got an honorable mention and put a little Greek temple on top of his tower. But I show this one because the Greek temples will reappear in Ferriss's drawings of this same time. The next, please. Now, the winning entry, of course, was Raymond Hood's Gothic tower, which was modeled on the butter tower of the Butter Guild's tower in Rouen. And its Gothic character was clear and certainly commented on at the time. But as when we talk about Hood next time, or in a couple of weeks, we'll be listening to him describe the unity of this form as it rises sheer as one shaft. So even though this building has a great deal of detail in its ornamentation and reference in its historicism, the idea that it was a single tower rising up straight and seen as a single sculptural form makes a kind of kinship between the concerns of Goodhue and Ferriss and Hood. The next, please. And the drawing that attracted so much praise and was the first runner-up after Hood's and it wasn't just Hood, but it was John Meade Howells and Hood together, Hood doing the rendering, but Howells, the much more famous architect who had invited Hood to participate with him. But much praised in the architectural press was the Finnish architect, Elil Saarinen's, designed for a tower which was considered very modern because it didn't have any historical reference to it. There is sculpture, and we'll see in some of the details, but like the Hood drawing or design, the sense of verticality in the emphasized mullions that rise straight up in the facade in a single plane, and then this telescoping setback was something that was seen as a kind of unity of design and a dignified expression by so many of the critics of the time. The next, please. It was also this drawing, which you can see in some of the hand drafting details that were published in the catalog for the Chicago Tribune competition. You can see the drafting style, which elated so many critics. And Saarinen had this characteristic style where he started to draw. It must have been quite amazing, as it was described by many people who could hardly believe their eyes, the facility that he had. He would start in the upper left-hand corner, and you can see those lines. He would just take a blank sheet of paper and render in diagonals across the plane of the paper like that, and pick out these details, which is a totally different rendering style than Ferriss, which we'll see in a series of images later. And you can see how certain darks are picked out and how certain details too are expressed through this amazing drafting style. The next, please. Now, Ferriss's characteristic style evolves, as we've seen, not in the 19-teens, but beginning in the 1920s, and especially, although it's predicted by certain descriptions about experiencing the city and the nature of architecture as being an architecture of mass in space, but the kind of crystallization of that idea comes in 1922 when he renders as a commission, working with Harvey Wiley Corbett, something called, there are a couple of different titles for this series of drawings called the Four Stages of the Zoning Envelope or the Maximum Mass of the Zoning Envelopes, and it's often just the four stages. And these images, let me see the next one, Meg. Yeah, these images, which we're going to look at a number of different times, are a description of what had been established by law in 1916 with the setback regulations that had been passed in the New York City zoning on the zoning resolution of 1916, which did a number of things. It divided the city up into separate zones of commercial, residential, and industrial, or non-designated. But the most important thing it did for architecture was, for the first time ever in American architecture, to make a template that restricted the mass of the building, so that before the zoning law, you could build. We talked about this last time, and we'll talk about it, especially with Harvey Wiley Corbett. You could take your full 100% of the lot that you owned and build straight up on the lot lines, 100% coverage of the lot, as tall as you wanted the building to be. And that, of course, made egregiously large buildings that stole the sun and daylight from the streets, that crowded too many people in small areas, especially in lower Manhattan. And the 1915 building, the Equitable Building at 120 Broadway, became kind of the last straw in making clear to everybody that something needed to be done in order to curtail the kind of uninhibited construction that had been allowed up till now. So the 1916 zoning law created this kind of template that meant that you had to set back a building from, next please, a line in the center of the street. And there were several zones. There were five different zones. And Lower Manhattan was the most liberal, where you could go 2.5 times the width of the street before you had to be able to begin to step back. And from the center of the street, this diagonal line to the first step back then established the angle by which these staircases need to step back. And you were allowed then to develop over a quarter of the site a tower to unlimited height. The next, please. And that gave a characteristic form for New York buildings that you can see by the early 1930s in Lower Manhattan or anywhere across New York, where, like in Midtown on 42nd Street or the East 40s or in the Garment District, where there was a great deal of construction. You see the buildings that set back according to the zoning law, not by a style that is embraced by architects as a new form, but as a rule that establishes the kinds of form, not in cookie cutter, because each site creates a new equation for each building. But you can see the characteristic forms of the ziggurat-like setback with a tower that's allowed over a quarter of the site, with these larger sites like the City Services or Citibank Farmers Trust or the 40 Wall Street that you see there. The next, please. Now, the zoning envelope drawings, or the maximum mass drawings, as Ferriss called them, described something that exaggerated the template that was created by the zoning law. So when you read the city code and you got a booklet from the Lawyers Title Association that described the zoning law, you saw only those diagrams. And from 1916 until 1922, the only way that anyone understood what was required by the zoning law was in those line drawings, the sort of wire form drawings. And some architects, especially Harvey Wiley Corbett, a real pioneer, began to explore what were the possibilities within the zoning law for a new form in architecture. What did the law demand? And I'm looking for the quote on that. Ferriss talks about how he was called in by Corbett to Corbett's office, and he said when he went there, here it is, he saw some diagrams on the wall. And he hadn't thought about this before at all, and it was an important insight for him and an important experience. He said, these diagrams exhibited the bare, vital facts of the zoning principle. The attitude of the architects was not one of hostility. They did not seek to evade any sense of the surprising forms before them. They accepted and analyzed them, their effort being to determine the most unaffected, comprehensive, and above all, the most practical method of expressing their nature, the nature of the building on a site, in structural form. But Ferriss, But what Corbett did was to enlarge the size of the lot, and Ferriss rendered it as a sculptural mass, so that this is a full cross street of 200 feet, and this is between 600 and 800 feet, so a full city block, to explore what would happen if one enlarged and exaggerated the principles of the zoning law onto a site that allowed you to create a tower that was truly profitable over a quarter of the site, so a massive tower, the tower that became the Empire State Building in the end, in this sort of natural evolution to the skyscraper not just becoming taller, but becoming bigger in every dimension, becoming a megastructure. So what you see here is called stage one, where you simply see the expression of that line wire drawing, but as if it's made of clay, as if it's molded or sculpted out of a malleable form. The next, please. And the second drawing shows light courts, because in this period office buildings were still illuminated principally by daylight. And the practicalities of office building design was that you never had a space that was farther from 28 feet from an outside window to an interior corridor, so that the floor plan that you would have in a very large building like that, like this, couldn't have deep space, deep dark space, so you had to cut big light wells out of the space. So this is what would happen practically to that form as you adjusted it to the requirements of the floor plan. And then the next one. And of course, you're building of a riveted steel frame, which is rectilinear by nature, so that each one of these setbacks, which is required by law and also the right angle of steel construction, begins to scale back. And you see that plane expressed in a sort of leaning ziggurat. And then the central really robust and gigantic tower rising over a quarter of the site. But by the time you get up to those little tops of the tower, you're no longer in a practical floor plan that can be serviced by elevators. The next, please. And so what you get naturally from the simple sort of equation, the form follows finance equation of the zoning law, is a building that cuts off, and Ferriss renders it here as about an 80-story building, 70 or 80 stories with 40-story shoulders, and a form like this that would cover a full city block. The next, please. That drawing, the last drawing to stage four, probably dates from 1925, and those four drawings still exist in the collection of the Cooper Hewitt Museum. But the original stage four is that was published in the New York Times is the one that you see here with the semblance of construction still being finished at the top. So the maximum the mass modified by construction. The next, please. And these drawings then were made for not just for the New York Times, although they were published in 1922 in the New York Times, but they were made for exhibition. They were published many, many times in the early 1920s, but they were shown in the Architectural League's exhibition in the fall of 1922. They then traveled in the spring of 1922, they traveled then to Detroit and Chicago. They were on display in Chicago during the time that the Chicago Tribune competition was still underway, so other architects might well have seen them. But not Saarinen, because he sent his entry in from Finland, and then he the next year, because of his acclaim, immigrated to the U.S. So these drawings were part of the popular consciousness. They were part of the argument in the architectural community about the direction for a new architecture, and they could have could have been seen by many people of influence, but they would certainly have been seen by anybody that read the New York Times. The next, please. Now, the drawing style that that evolved as an outgrowth of the zoning envelope series took a while to develop. And in 1922, Ferriss was already interested, as you could see from his own article called The New Architecture. He was interested in the civic dimension of the influence of the zoning law, but he hadn't found an expression yet that really seemed to resonate with the idea of modernity, the new architecture, but not modern architecture yet. It wasn't yet defined. And as he searched for an expression for his own ideas about the direction of the city of the future, he took the mass of the forms, of these great pyramidal and ziggurat forms, but he adapted them, as architects characteristically did in the time, with historical styles. And so the first series of drawings in 1922 that he then published in articles in Vanity Fair and in the Arts and Decoration, an English periodical, and every place that he could sell a drawing, he was delighted to have the opportunity to both make some money and to make his reputation. And so in great demand were these visions of the future metropolis. So he did a whole series of them. The next, please. And they all explore the idea of a full block building pared down into a simpler form, but always with a recognizable sort of historicist tag, whether it's a kind of Byzantine shell dome or the striations, but within classical temples on top. But within these drawings, there's also a kind of incipient urbanism, like these open plazas and reflecting pool. There's both monumentality and a public realm that speaks to the idea of city planning, and indeed, as he called it, the argus-eyed view of the city itself. The next, please. And in this drawing of 1923-24, you see, again, a densely developed city with a sort of limited public space, all on an open plain. Later in the 20s, these will become multi-level transit separation. But still, this is more like a sort of imperial Rome. It's a vision of any kind of city in history, of whether it's Babylon or Rome. It is intensely developed. And it separates its elite on the upper floors from the life of the street. And of course, you don't see the life of the poor. Next, please. Now, the same historicism one sees here in the commissioned drawing that Harvey Wiley Corbett asked Ferriss to do, to take that the simplicity of that naked sculpted form and to decorate it with a cupola on top and a bunch of little temples, and to perforate it with a series of windows. This is the vocabulary of architects that are exploring a modern expression, but they're still attached to the language of history in which they've been educated, especially educated in the Beaux-Arts tradition. The next, please. And we've seen it before, the article that Corbett wrote on the coming city of setback skyscrapers. The next, please. Corbett, as we'll discuss the next time, really became a leader in investigating these ideas, especially the separation of people and cars, and then wheeled transit, and then vehicular transit, and then rail transit below. So multi-level separations of traffic responded to the terrible congestion that was being experienced throughout New York and most American cities, where cars were invading, and not only were they invading, but they were causing a tremendous number of fatalities or injuries by pedestrians. So an obsessive concern of this period is, how do you keep people and cars apart? How do you keep the foot realm of the city still as gracious as it can be, but the lifeblood of the commercial city still flowing? Corbett used the analogy of the canals, like in Venice, and the bridges that crossed. So that in the drawings that Ferriss made for, for Corbett, as Corbett was one of the committee members for the Regional Plan of New York, so that he was paid by the Regional Plan, in order to create these views of a monumentalized city of the near future, not this fantasy vision of the sort of imperial grandeur or operatic theatricality, but a vision of the city that was really responding to the contemporary problems of the real city of New York. The next, with upper level plazas, we've seen this before. The next, please. Loges, and to protect you from the sun and to stroll and to have trysts and like a great European city. Also created in 1923-24 for the Regional Plan Association is a drawing that we have over here in the gallery. This is for an art center. You can see it has a kind of Doge's Palace Venetian quality to the lower buildings, and then there's a tower that seems to disappear into the sky so that you can't tell exactly how tall it is. But a characteristic Ferrissian vision of the city at night sort of dissolving into the darkness, dramatically highlighted forms, that was done for Corbett in order to recommend directions that the regional plan might embrace in order to not just solve the problems of the city and commuters and housing projects at a distance from the center, but also the ornaments of the city, the embellishments, and the artistic life of the city. The next, please. Now, just to put in a sort of question mark into the discussion, it's often alleged or described in textbooks on European and American architecture that not only was Saarinen's drawing for the Chicago Tribune a tremendous influence on the development of American modernism in the later 1920s, but also this particular project, which he published in 1923 and 24, for a civic center on the lakefront in Chicago for a businessman, sort of in the same spirit as Daniel Burnham's 1909 plan of Chicago, but now embracing the skyscraper and the commercial architecture as the centerpiece. So that this was published at the time in 23-24, and one often reads in books like by Manfredo Tafuri, The Disenchanted Mountain, about the chapter called The Disenchanted Mountain about the American skyscraper, that it was the European influence on American architects that showed them the light, that sort of led the way to an increasing simplicity and monumentality that became the direction of American modernism in the late 1920s. Ferriss might have seen this drawing, but I think it's utterly clear from the evolution of his own drawing style and the clear articulation in his writings and in the drawings themselves that the zoning envelope not only influenced Ferriss's direction about the way that he understood architecture and the sort of inchoate modernity of the simple form, but it then directed his whole evolution, not just of the drawing style, but an idea about where urbanism was to go in the later 20s. And when I mean in the later 20s, I mean just after 1922. Because in, the next please, in 1923, that's not the direction New York is going to go, but we'll hold off on that for a moment. In 1923, he wrote to his father. He says, "Between ourselves, I value very little my abilities as a delineator. I must either prove myself a creator dealing with structural masses or admit that my career is negligible. If I had the time to give to it, I should make an exhibition full of original drawings of interest to all who are concerned with the future of New York and be able to predict and study these future forms in my drawings even more effectively than a practicing architect who necessarily is occupied for a long time on each building he undertakes." And you can see that in the previous drawings for Corbett as well. So we'll explore that in a minute, but this little time machine travel to Solomon's Temple actually is a contemporary work of the 1920s. It was for a rather wacky religious man who had the idea that at the Philadelphia sesquicentennial fair of 1926, he would recreate the whole precinct of the Temple of Solomon. And so it would be a kind of religious Disneyland where you would come and the temple would, you know, would burn down on, you know, several times a day, and you would be able to visit all the different pavilions. And he engaged Corbett's enthusiasm in this project, and Corbett in turn brought Ferriss in order to make the series of renderings. So there was a whole dozen or so renderings created of this of a fantasy Temple of Solomon precinct based on some good archaeological evidence that Ferriss undoubtedly looked at, but rendered in a way that makes a skyscraper the centerpiece for the whole. So this series, the next please, this is Ferriss's drawing for Corbett. It's in Avery Library in a pen and ink style, so it's not his characteristic style so much as the rest of the sequence where he uses charcoal and he does these theatrical scenography panoramas of what each one of these great pavilions would look like, and he populates them with casts of thousands and dancing girls in some that you'll see. The next, please. So these are Ferriss's series from that, except for this, of course, which is shows you the interest in the period, because in 1916 or 18, D.W. Griffith's film Intolerance included this spectacular recreation of the fall of Babylon. This clearly influenced Ferriss. I mean, you see the same trumpeting elephants in this that you see in Ferriss. And this the whole set piece, which of course was, you know, built in 3D in Hollywood with the cast of thousands down here, is something which was entirely credible to any American because they'd seen it in the movies. The next, please. And Ferriss let his imagination go too. Here's like the Dance of the Veils the night lighting and plumed fans and all of that you can see in the background in this hypostyle hall. The next, please. And more fans and dancing girls. So it was a vision definitely meant to appeal, but not great surprise. They did not raise the required funding in order to realize their dreams. Go back one because, okay, no, four, yeah, okay. So this was the centerpiece, Temple for Solomon, Temple of Solomon. And then the next one, so this ziggurat was included in the Metropolis of Tomorrow, as was this drawing, which is called Modern Ziggurats. So it takes the same form and inspiration and turns it into night illumination of a skyscraper form. Next, please. So Ferriss remained attached to history in a lot of ways, and his inclination for this kind of theatrical presentation, I think, keeps sort of battling with the modern sensibility that he clearly recognized in his drawings of the zoning envelope. And he wrote of the four stages, imagine, he said, that the law placed upon the property a huge mass of clay and stated, your building must be built of this clay. Remove as much as you want, but add nothing to it, so a sculptural form. He says, the law demolishes the box and produces a pyramid which must be sculpted in three dimensions. And this becomes the fundamental truth for architecture for Ferriss. The next, please. And it does then continue to inform his evolution as a modern architect, as a delineator of modern architecture, and it enormously influences the architectural community. Now, in a series of drawings that he made that came out of the inspiration of the zoning law, he fulfilled this idea that he wrote to his father about creating a series of drawings that he would put together into an exhibition, which he did in 1925, and this was one of the drawings that was in there called Crude Clay for Architects. He also managed to market these successfully as a series of advertisements, and he exhibited them in various architectural, like the Architectural League annual, so that these were widely seen, not just by the sort of gallery goers that might have attended his future city exhibition. The next, please. So Crude Clay for Architects. You can see has strong relationships to the, this is an example of the practice that then was embraced by so many of the modernist inclined architects. This is the first massing study for the Daily News building by Raymond Hood, and it's in the book by Walter Killam that I was praising so much, because Killam took these pictures in 1928 when he was a young graduate just out of Harvard GSD and came to New York in order to get his first job with the architects of his dreams, who was Hugh Ferriss. And he documents a lot of the early studies, including the ones in clay, and he talks about when Hood took a carving knife to this plasticine and said, "I'm going to do a little zoning now." And he sliced the clay away. He, from this form, after this form, he sliced it into a sheer tower. Killam, much like Frank Lloyd Wright, talked of Louis Sullivan and the expression of the Wainwright building as sort of one sheer rise, the sort of the thing itself, that there was a sort of revelation of the building that arrives. But it's a revelation that's made by sculpting mass. The next, please. And it's Ferriss who delivers this vision to the architects who didn't see it before. They say that over and over again in praising him throughout the 1920s. I'm not sure. They say things like John Mead Howells, "When Hugh Ferriss made those four drawings of the zoned envelope on a city block, the matter was crystallized." And others said, a critic in Art News, "There was a great deal of heated opposition to the zoning law in New York, but Mr. Ferriss showed the architects that the new restriction was in reality a splendid possibility." And there are dozens of such testimonials to the influence of these drawings, which sort of lifted the veil. The architects were recognized the modernity of the simplified forms as they were exposed through Ferriss's drawings. The next, please. This one's in the buildings and the modeling is in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art still. And Ferriss found his style. He found his voice, I guess you'd say, in recent parlance, his voice in charcoal through those drawings, expressing the sculptural mass, the simplicity of the sculptural mass, carving it, of stone or solid, lighting it to dramatize and to reveal the forms and the receding planes. The next, please. And finding in buildings which had really still a great deal of reference to historical styles, but into the tradition of architecture that was stretching back through the teens and the late 19th century, but conforming as they must have done to the zoning law. So the first building that was really talked about as the new an expression of the simplicity of the new architecture was the Shelton Hotel. You saw Ferriss's drawing before, and here it is in a photograph. The next, please. And Ferriss drew in 23 or 24 a whole series of these new architectural expressions that were already constructed based on the zoning law, the Shelton, the Fisk building, the Heckscher building, and Standard Oil, and some others. So you can see he's making this argument about the new architecture, but he's also making the futurist argument that zoning will change the city. The next, please. And this is to remind me about the Anderson Galleries. Next, please. The show of the drawings that he compiled, that he had written to his father as his aspiration in 1923. So in April 1925, he mounted this show called Drawings of the Future City. This is what survives of the unframed. He rendered on a map board. He drew in charcoal, as you can see here. This is called Buildings Like Mountains. So nature was also one of the inspirations for him. So sculpted either by man's hand or the sort of the eternal time of ages, like the pyramids or mountainous forms of nature. This is again Avery's drawing, but you can see his technique where the charcoal is laid heavy on, and then it's rubbed smooth, and actually highlights are created with a kneaded eraser in order to take the light by removing. So he actually is imitating that idea of sculpting the form like clay in a charcoal method. So he takes away, he's actually subtracting. And then the color that you see laid over here is shellac, which he used in order to stabilize the fugitive charcoal, and that has aged over the years so that it turns to this more amber hue. The next, please. And so the series of drawings that he compiled in 1925, you can see here, and these are all buildings of his imagination. This one called Steel, you can see, is very close to the stage four of the zoning envelope. It does develop with the windows and the whole facade, the fenestration, in a way that is completely plausible as a modern office building, but gigantic compared to anything that would be built in New York, but not so tall as the ambitions of the later part of the decade, so 1929, when the Empire State Building would go to 80 stories, and this one is probably about 60, and to 1,250 feet. 1,000 feet is what Ferriss mentioned in his writings. The next, please. This one called Concrete, so he explores the different materials. But again, you can see how the form seems to be carved out of stone, and the highlighting comes as the light, like the light that hits the east facades he talked about in the morning, as the city's buildings sort of become revealed by the light of the dawn. Those highlights then create the form which emerges out of the darkness, or out of the charcoal. The next, please. And the four stages here compiled all in one city view. The next. These drawings all were gathered together in Metropolis. So the famous book of 1929 is really a compilation over the decade from 1922, especially this group of drawings, imaginary city drawings of 1925, and then others he explored in the years in between. This building looking very much like the municipal building, which of course was built by 1914-15, and has that big arch through which traffic was supposed to flow here, rather enlarged in scale, but nevertheless a precedent that already existed in New York. The next, please. And then his imagination starts to enlarge and sort of abstract this vision, so that you can see here the suggestion of a highway that's four or five stories that's tunneling through the megastructure with these great shoulder buildings on either side, and then a tower which could go to any height above. It's just it breaks the boundaries of the frame. The next, please. Another idea that he explored, and we've already seen it in a number of the historical images, and this one has a kind of historical quality to it, is roof gardens. Now, in the early 1920s, penthouses were still considered to be the least inexpensive, and they were sort of the dregs of housing, because penthouses simply meant the superstructures on a roof that housed equipment, mechanical equipment for a building. In 1928, the multiple dwellings law changed so that the high-rise apartment buildings could rise above the 90-foot height, I think, of the tenement house law, and they could then become multiple dwelling skyscrapers. Before 1928, and then you get the whole range of buildings like Central Park West, and actually you're allowed two towers, two-tower forms like Majestic or the Century. But before that time, like the Shelton Hotel, there were residential skyscrapers, but they were hotels. They were nominally hotels because they had no cooking facilities within the individual apartment. So if you had a kitchen, then you were governed by the tenement house law. You had to be a flat roof and no higher than 90 feet. But if you were a commercial building, you were governed by the zoning law. But this was then liberalized in 1928. So when Ferriss draws this in 1925-26, penthouses are not allowed, although he and his wife did live on the top floor of the Osborne, where they had the equivalent of a penthouse in their own garden terraces. The next, please. And that he lets his imagination monumentalize even more in this sort of vision of the future city, with just about every historical reference you can find, including a bridge of size right there. The next, please. And then another drawing of another series of drawings that he does that explores these same ideas, and with a collaboration with Harvey Wally Corbett, in an exhibition called The Titan City. At the next, please, the John Wanamaker store in October 1925. The Wanamaker stores were down on Broadway at 9th and 10th Street, and there were two of them, the old one and the new one by Daniel Burnham up there. And within the two stores and throughout them, the next, please, was installed a vision of the future city, as well as a historical panorama of New York's history. So the Titan City was New York. The tercentennial celebration from 1626 to 1926 went everywhere from the Colonial Foundation, the Indian Native American first inhabitants, up through all of the 19th century history of the city. But it culminated in the Ferriss views of the future city. And we looked at this last time, and we'll look at it again with Ferriss, but the monoplane that occupied the center floor of the men's suit department. The next, please. With Ferriss's drawings of the zoning envelope in the back. And here's Ferriss painting those large 12-foot murals that would be installed in the store. The next, please. And some of them that are recorded in the single document that seems to exist about the Titan City, which is a folio of photographs of all of the renderings, not just Ferriss's, that's in the New York Public Library. And so you can see these the same drawings that you've seen in charcoal now monumentalized in these paintings, which I think were enlarged through painted over a photographic base. The next, please. And essentially the good hue form of the Convocation Tower turned into the cathedral center of the future city. The next, please. including skyscraper airports on the tops of buildings. The next, please. And apartments on bridges and residential communities. For skyscraper living and bridge homes that he collaborated with Hood on. The next, please. Collaborated in this very article that authored by Hood with the Ferriss commissioned illustration in a somewhat different version than the one we've seen before and maybe next. Next. Well, this is the 1929 version which is a photo montage drawn over with the bridge communities that Hood suggested. And the next. And Ferriss's own drawing, which he then published in Metropolis, which dates back to 1926, that changes a little bit some of the details from the Hood Commission. So he clearly wanted to own this image himself. The next, please. Own it as an author. Now, that idea about architecture as mass and the debate about the direction of modernism is articulated And throughout the mid-1920s, about 1925, 26, especially 1927 and into the last years of the decade, by people like Sheldon Cheney, who wrote the book called The New World Architecture, and you can see clearly it is a partisan in this case of the architecture as mass. The next, please. And mass and glass are sort of the two alternative directions that are explored by the architects and by the writers. So image of it, but the glass skyscraper by Frank Lloyd Wright, who really doesn't figure that importantly in the discussions during these years, but on the frontispiece of the Cheney book. And the next, please. And on the first page is the statement of Hugh Ferriss of buildings and the modeling of these sculpted forms, abstract, their inchoate modernity described, and then in Cheney's own very florid text. The next, please. And the second last page of Cheney's book is this one, The City as Architecture, Life as Art, where Ferriss, who appears throughout the book, and as do many other architects, is featured as a futurist, an urban futurist. But the very last page, the next one, holds the image of Le Corbusier, from his ideas for the future city that were published first, the Plan of Voisin, in 1922, along the same lines of the horizontality and sort of vehicular speed and spread of the residential zones that are outside the business zones of his famous glass cruciform towers. Corbusier then also published his book Urbanisme in 1925, but it was translated in 1929 in English and appeared at the same time as The Metropolis of Tomorrow, so they were often reviewed together. The next, please. And as they appeared in the Cheney book in 1930. So that this debate between international style, European avant-garde modernism and a sort of Native American modernism is something which is very much discussed in architectural circles and in architectural magazines in the late years of the decade, so especially 1927, 28, and 29. The next, please. That, of course, was the Museum of Modern Art International Style Show or Modern Architecture in 1932 MoMA show that has a title, the exact title of which is escaping me, but it spawned the international style book by Philip Johnson and Henry Russell Hitchcock. So that the direction of American modernism after the 1930s, early 1930s, will go towards architecture as volume, not mass, of horizontality rather than verticality, of thin planes and ribbon windows, of an expression of structure as opposed to a carved monumentality of lithic forms that we saw that comes out of the Ferriss revelation of the zoning law, zoning envelope. The next, please. By the early 1930s, a direction of modernism which is more streamlined, it's glassier, it's shinier, is beginning to adapt to some of the influences of European modernism that come not out of the Parisian 1925 exposition of the Exposition des Arts Décoratifs et Industriels that spawned Art Deco, but the directions of Le Corbusier, of the Bauhaus, of some of the Dutch modernists of De Stijl, who emphasized the planarity and the lightness of forms. The next, please. But Ferriss remained true to the sculpted simplicity. New York of the Future, commissioned by Vanity Fair in 1926, was later described by Ferriss as crowding towers. Here it's lofty terraces, topless towers, a kind of romanticism. But the next, please. As he moved into the 20s, further into the 20s, he began to critique some of the excessive romanticism of these sort of elite towers, and began to think more in more utopian terms about spread out urbanism. The glass skyscraper he also explores with quoted through here and his own drawing and an article by one of his friends, or Don's, the next please. Forms that are clearly supposed to be glass towers, which wasn't a technical possibility at the time. This is in 1926. It actually was first rendered for Raymond Hood, but then he then takes it over for Metropolis of Tomorrow as well. Here his forms have a kind of crystalline quality, which again makes glass a solid rather than as a membrane. The next, please. And he explores this in 28th in 1927, in the Machine Age exposition, where the glass skyscraper designed by Hugh Ferriss is a sensational feature. The next, please. We don't know exactly what it looks like, but it probably had something to do with that earlier tower for Hood, and points towards the Tower of Philosophy in the Metropolis of Tomorrow. But again, you can see the logic of the plan as a kind of geometry that generates the crystalline form and its facets. The next, please. And you see that in philosophy, where the mathematical ratios in the telescoping form play out according to a kind of mystic and occult numerology. The next, please. Explores, well, we'll talk about this next time with Corbett, an idea for, in fact, a glass tower, a glass facade, a curtain wall facade for an obviously unrealized building for the Metropolitan Life Insurance Company. Next, please. So we'll end quickly now with the Metropolis of Tomorrow and a whole range of the drawings that compile his thoughts across the decade. The next, please. This is from the dust jacket, and the book is divided up into three parts. Here we're seeing plates from two of the pages together. There, each individual page gets a single building, and in the first section, the present city is the subject, and he takes buildings which have been constructed, like the Master Apartments by Harvey Wiley Corbett and the Belden Project that was designed by Corbett but never realized, and the next two. And you can see the difference between drawings which are commissioned by the architect or the client, which are much more highly articulated in their surface detail, and the drawings that have a little bit more of the sort of quintessential Ferriss personality in them, where buildings like the Channon Building are seen at night, likewise 40 Wall Street, with a kind of aura of the moon behind it that turns that into just a single sculptural silhouette. The next, please. And by contrast, this is not Hugh Ferriss, but Chester Price, you see what other delineators were doing at the same time, so that this 1929 drawing of One Wall Street has the same kind of Saarinen detail of individual lines rendered as surface texture rather than as solid planes and removed in this kind of subtractive process like Ferriss's erasures. The next, please. Shell Lewis, a garment district building, where you see how each one of the windows and the brickwork striations are all detailed. The next, please. So Ferriss had an extremely distinctive vision. He also, in the book, looks across America at developments in other cities with skyscrapers, like Detroit, these two examples. The next, please. Or in Los Angeles, there with the City Hall, or one of the early stages in this first design iteration, published in 1929, but before the building is really formed its real identity. This is the Empire State Building, when it's called the Waldorf Astoria Project. The next, please. In the second section of the book, this projected trends talks about some of the directions, includes the zoning envelope drawings, and it talks about some of the directions that cities seem to be going that need to be drawn back in, so that this kind of hyper density is being critiqued by Ferriss. The next, please. and Crowding Towers, as I said, what had been created for an editor at Vanity Fair as a kind of, you know, inebriated idea of the future city is now carries a text by Ferriss in 1929 that says, this is the direction it's going. You know, this is a cautionary tale. We can't sustain this kind of intensive development. The next, please. And what he offers as an antidote is his imaginary Metropolis, which is the third part of the book, where skyscraper centers occupy half-mile distances. They are megastructures that have a tower and related lower-rise buildings around them, and each one is devoted to a separate function. There's a radial plan, as you see, in the next one. We'll just go through these quickly. Like the business center, this is actually a drawing that dates back as, to 1926, but it's consistent with the all of the 1929 sort of the set pieces of that he establishes for the imaginary city. The next, please. The drawing for this you see from the Avery Sketches on Trace, so how he constructs the form and the perspective is actually a two-point perspective. It gives more, he describes a more sense of dynamism. The next, please. From an elevated view in the business zone where you see the building frame being erected in the foreground and in closer detail how the highways express through the body of the building, like in the municipal building, and how large courtyards around these centers of business provide light, air, and rooftop amenities. The next, please. At the end of the book, he draws the plan of the city, and at the very last page, he says the city could be made in the image of man, who is made in the image of mystery, because one would naturally think God there, but there's not room for three letters, so it's, you know, this is probably a tongue-in-cheek description. But Ferriss is very serious about his philosophy. In fact, he was a follower of Gurdjieff, of Theosophy, and a proponent in New York, whose name was Orage. And Ferriss got involved in some of the sort of bohemian circles of the Little Review and New York Greenwich Village intellectuals through his sympathy for Gurdjieff's theosophical philosophy, which included numbers. It included this kind of pictograph that was supposed to be looks like the Star of David, but it's a kind of ultimate equilibrium. It becomes the generator of the radial avenues. It also establishes the module of the blocks and the regularity, and these are the skyscraper centers that are over the intersections. So an idealized utopian, perhaps, but if you think of utopian, maybe not as good place, but a place that stays unchanged forever, because once you get to perfection, I guess there's nowhere you can go from there. So the argument, there's a kind of end game of utopia, which is stasis. And that vision that he imagines and he projects in the Metropolis is something that seems so foreign to us today, but received some very credible reviews and applause back when the book first appeared in 1929. And let's go to the next one, please. We'll see the other views while I look for this. It of course plays off the idea of master planning, like the Chicago 1909 plan by Daniel Burnham. Next, please. And you see in the sketch on the back side of a letter that was sent to a theosophist who was out in Minnesota, Emil Lorsch, some of his sketching for the original city plan. The next, please. The art center. In monumental buildings that are actually derived from drawings that he did of Asian temples of Angkor Wat. And the next, please. Or the Center for Science. So there's business, science, and art. Actually, this is the Art Center. The next, please. Science. these grand avenues cutting through the megastructures, separating pedestrians and vehicles, as Corbett and others had called for in the early 20s. The next, please. The Center for Technology that stands at the nexus where the different radial avenues sort of splice together, there you have a hierarchy that's established by business, science, and art, technology being between business and science. The next, please. The cathedral evolved out of the Goodhue design for Convocation Tower in 1921. The next, please. And night in the science zone, where the idea of a building like crystals is the phrase that Ferriss used to describe this tower. So the inspiration of nature, too. But again, nature that sees glass as a mass rather than as a transparent plane or membrane. The next, please. And the most exquisite drawing I think he ever did, the Tower of Philosophy, which survives in Avery Library, and as I said before, has a numerology that projects the sort of ascending sections of the the tower. The next, please. Now, where does this go, finally, Metropolis? I'm looking for the quotes, but they're not all that important. Some people applauded it. Some found it. Many found it inspiring. Some even found it logical. Some, like Lewis Mumford, called it sort of the evil plan of Mammon and an incredibly insidious design because, as he said, it was so powerful and iconic that it even seduced the normally rational planners of the regional plan of New York. But where does the future city go after the stock market crashes in October 1929? One place that the future city goes is to Rockefeller Center, the one realized three-block section of the city of the future planned exactly as these leaders of American modernism, Corbett, Ferriss, and Hood, imagined them. And this is the first plan for Rockefeller Center that Corbett presented as rendered by Ferriss, and we'll look at many more when we look at the Rockefeller Center in the last section. The next, please. And it becomes embraced in the popular culture in a way that one sees it in the Mujica drawing of a 100-story city in the neo-American style of 1930, in the next, please. Or these are all in our exhibition, and the Hollywood Fox film called Just Imagine, also of 1930, where the set designer said it was Hugh Ferriss who influenced their vision of the future city. But of course, it was really New York that influenced all of this. Ferriss continued to make drawings of the future city in the early 1930s, like this one that emphasizes landing platforms for gyroscopes and all. So the sort of technological future and its romance is something that still figures very importantly in advertisements in the early 1920s for trade associations and manufacturers like the American Institute of Steel Construction or Lehigh Concrete. And these were rendered as advertisements with big banners over the top, like, you know, the world is made in steel. The next, please. So he made a living, continued to make a living from these. And the next, please. And by the mid-1930s, for architects Reinhard and Hofmeister, who came out of the Associated Architects of Rockefeller Center with something of a reputation that allowed them to imagine future cities too, at least for the magazines, and they hired Ferriss in order to render them. Here you can see the city begins to spread out. It's not really a Ferriss vision, it's really a modernist vision of separation and lower-rise buildings influenced by, if not in the specific styles of the building, by Le Corbusier, but by European modernism. And the next, please. And then he continued, go back for one for a second while I just read this quote of where Ferriss recalled his post-depression, the Great Depression, attitude towards the inebriated decade of the 1920s. He says, He writes reflectively in 1942. In 1930, standing on the parapet of the Architects Building, a studio destitute of jobs, below a strangely quiet Manhattan, with riveting machines silenced. Like others, I had been enchanted with the New York skyline. Now the scene was appearing in its true and rather somber colors. These towering masses seemed monuments to the rugged individualism of the period, their topmost unnecessary floors and gilded spires to the conspicuous waste of rampant advertising, their long shadows across the slums at their feet to the exploitation. The whole scene showed up the laissez-faire, the competition, and of long-term planning, hardly the vestige. He sounds depressed. He had suffered the depression. The economic depression and a period of remorse, I guess, skyscraper remorse, Metropolis remorse. His income, which is said had been $19,000 or $20,000 in 1929, dropped to 1/10 of that in 1931, and he was still only making, I think it was $3,600 in 1936. So it was a very long period of decline. There wasn't much work. And in that time the whole of America and the world experienced the hardships of the Depression, Ferriss also sort of inclined his political beliefs towards investigations of socialism. Perhaps it's sort of a little bit of refrain of maybe going to a communist meeting is sort of friends in the bohemian world of Greenwich Village probably surrounded him with that kind of political discourse. But he really does seem to have been embarrassed by his youthful exaggerations, optimism, and idealism of the early 1920s, at least thinking that capitalism would build us a better world. And he very specifically rejects that in his 1930s writings. His daughter, Jean Lake, who wrote an interesting book called Architectural Visions about her father with an essay and many of these illustrations, said that he really didn't like to talk about the metropolis of tomorrow. When asked about it in interviews, he generally sort of shied away from the subject and rejected this kind of ownership of the idea. The next, please. And his career continued as an important architectural delineator and often the lead imagist on a team, like at the New York World's Fair of 1939. The next, please. Or let's go to the next one. The UN, where he was the delineator who sort of mediated among the modern architects like Corbusier and Niemeyer and others who came to the U.S. in order to conceive the plaza as an icon of not just international peace, but the international style as well. And you can see how ill-suited his architectural delineating technique is to the idea of modernism. These still look like they're solid forms. The next, please. Likewise, the same conventions that he used from the 1920s to make buildings which are membranes of steel and forms prismatic forms, but planar as perfect examples of modernism, he turns into the kind of tombstones of solid stone. He was still extremely successful in doing this, in serving in this capacity for a whole range of activities and developers and international committees, but you can see that his heart wasn't in this kind of architectural expression. And go back one, Emma, then. Go back another one. Architecture changed from his setback forms to the 1961 zoning law, which is being explored here in the 1950s in a series of drawings he was asked to do for the City Planning Commission, to describe the slab architecture raised up on pilotis. I mean, it's the utter antithesis of the idea of his buildings being carved out of clay. But he renders those, and that is the future of architecture, not his setback ziggurats. The next, please. And then go forward to... He seems to find then... Well, he has other commissions. This is also the another version of the UN. But he seems to find his emotion again in a road trip that he takes across the U.S. In 1953, and it results in a series of sketches that are compiled in a book called Power and Buildings. And there he visits the monuments of American architecture and modernism, and there are highways and roads and Frank Lloyd Wright's Taliesin, but the place where he finds the architecture that he really admires, as you can see so clearly through the drawings, and where his style really fits the emotion and, or the truth of the building, as he described it way back in the early 1920s, is in the great dam projects, the PWA projects. This is Hoover Dam. So the products of the Depression, but lithic, I mean, concrete, massive forms, sculpted, seen at night, dramatized through light. And it's in drawings like this that he seems once again to find his subject. The next, please. The last one. He lives until 1962, remains extremely successful, a prominent figure, often interviewed, active in architectural circles as a leader, sort of central fixture at the Architectural League and the three-hour lunch club, as they called it. He also smoked himself to death because he died of lung cancer in 1962. So this figure, who I think represents in so many ways the search and the evolution of a modern architecture that comes out of the conditions of the modern city, that transcends it too through his poetic spirit, so that he finds in the zoning law, in the practical application of the zoning law, not just a style for his drawings and a modern style for buildings, but a language for civic architecture. And in this way, I think he's a companion, and the book, The Metropolis of Tomorrow, is a companion to the great visionary architects like Ledoux and Boulez, or of Tony Garnier in modernism, or Le Corbusier, of course, as a builder. But if we think of the visionaries who didn't so much build, but still influenced architecture from their roles as draftsmen, I'll just read, which is actually, I wrote, not Ferriss wrote, but my last paragraph, I wrote it some time ago. I said it was in the 1920s that Ferriss transcended his role as a commercial artist. In that decade, his distinctive personal style, his emphasis on simple but powerful mass, combined with his flair for the dramatic, seemed to resonate with the times. Great drawing has a historical dimension. As Piranesi's polemic of the superiority of Roman architecture, or Santalia's futurist celebration of speed and technology, Ferriss's drawings of the 1920s limed a historical moment filtered through one artist's vision. His images of the skyscraper city, real and ideal, seem to embody the energy and optimism of capitalist prosperity at its zenith. So the influence of The Metropolis of Tomorrow, I think, is as an expression of its times, is killed by the times that follow, so that its influence is negligible, but still as a swan song of the development of modernism in the 1920s, I think it remains without parallel. So that's it on Hugh Ferriss for tonight.